you know, asking forgiving, like when you doing it for yourself, not for the people. Because forgiving is the root of your breath. It's the root of your breath. Because you can't get that person on your mind and you offer prayers, then it will go. Mm-mm. You have to forgive. You have to forget it. I see people say, myself used to say, I will forgive the person. But not that if you forgive, you forget. Mm-mm. Mm-mm. But when you forgive, it happens that the person, when you hear them talking, you will not remember again. You will not remember that that person did that thing to you. She cried again. No. If you forgive, if it comes from in your heart and you forgive that person, you can remember. But you can't forget. No. But the way you will remember and it will make you vex and you will think what to do to that person, I will pay my debt. No. No, you can't pay your debt. Because now it comes from your heart that you forgive.
Right.
Then it comes from your heart that you forgive that person. And it finished. When that person go do anything, then now you will pray. When you pray to God, then God will answer you. But when you not pray, when you get a grudge in your heart, the other person did a thing, the other person did a thing, the other person did a thing, and then you keep it special, because you keep it special from then now. Oh. Yeah, I will not talk. I will not talk. I will not talk. When church out there, go about my business. When church off, when the people decide to say something in the church, or the church women going to say something, or the men going to say something, when church all that, you pick up your book, your Bible, you gone. Now, tell me where will you pass? And the God that you serve will forgive you. No. So I see that forgiving is for yourself. Mm-hmm. It is not for the person you're doing it to. Forgiving is for yourself. Mm-hmm. That's how I feel. That's how I feel. Because you forgive that person. You making a way for your prayer to be answered, for your Christian life to be straight. But you not forgive, you stay keeping something in your heart. Mary do this, Sarah do this, Elisha do this, and you keeping it. Then you pray to God. You pray. How you will manage now and your prayer will be answered? How you will manage? Because God, you doing it too. God is a spirit. He with you. Though we can pray, God not hearing me. I used to say, may God he hear me. God not hear me. I can remember one time I came to the church and I was confused. I was disturbed and I couldn't tell anybody. We were all vigil in that and we were going home now. The pastor came. He said, "You think God not hear you?" I said, "Papa, I didn't tell the pastor. I didn't tell them." He said, "He hear you." I think. I said, "Wow." So you hear me, eh? Yo, I said, "So you hear me?" Oh. And in all the distress, I don't say you hear me, yo. But it left in my mind because I never open my mouth. I don't talk to my children in the house. I just keep him quiet. But he was able to tell the man of God that you think God forgot about you? I said, "Wow." So God is with you. Now you pray. You pray for something that worry you, that worry you. And you pray, "God, you pray." But those people that they don't think to you, you get them in heart, then you pray. How God will answer you? So you're doing it to yourself because when you forgive them, then the Almighty God will forgive you. And then your prayer will make room in heaven. But when you not forgive, you can pray. You can pray.
Okay. Let's look at something. Because we get today, there are 2 points now. One, from what you just made, which is true. It's difficult to be heard by God when you don't forgive.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when you're harboring unforgiveness.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the Bible said. If you want to give your offering, as simple as that sounds, and you know that you remember that there's somebody that you have in your heart, that you're, in other words, that you're not forgiven, you should not even drop the offering.
Mm-hmm.
You should go back first. Make peace with that person even before you come back and drop your offering.
Mm-hmm.
It follows, therefore, that many of the things we do in the house of God do not come with the required blessing. What do I mean? If it's true, which I know it is, what the Bible just said, it means that we can pay tithe, we can give offering, we can labor the house of God without any blessing. God, on Wednesday we're talking about the doctrine of Christ, that anybody that does not carry the doctrine of Christ, we should not. Now we talk about what is the doctrine of Christ, all everything Christ teaches us to do. We must do and obey. So I can see why many times we do things in the house of God or outside the house of God for God, diligently, with all our mind, all our effort. Yet, the promise of God attached to what we do has not come to pass in our lives. It is very critical when it comes to forgiveness.
Mm-hmm.
Because even to sit there, to stay with somebody together to pray, that not see something against you and you are praying together, that prayer is not going anywhere.
It doesn't even hit the ceiling.
You can fast for 40 days without food or water. You are wasting your time. So it becomes important. I wish there were many people here to listen to this. It's important that we look inward and forgive ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Look inward and search ourselves. Where have we gone wrong? Because when we talk about offense, this offense is a two-way street. You say this person offends me badly. You don't even know that person might be saying the same thing about you.
You might have contributed to that.
Uh-huh. So if it's not only you, it also involves another person too. So when we're looking at ourselves, this person offends me, we also have to look inward and ask, what have I done to contribute to this offense? Because there's no way it would be very difficult, although there could be instances where there's 100% offense from somebody. But for the most part, it's going to be a ratio, 50-50, 60-40, 70-30, it can even be 90-10. So we need to look inward and ask ourselves, why is it that when I pray, answers should not come? Many times I ask myself the same question. It's like I pray, some things I'm looking up to God for. They take a long time, it's like it's not coming the way I expected. I'm like, have I not prayed? So you come to realize that it's not all about prayer. Sometimes you might not even pray for hours and answers start coming because you have made your relationship with God and with man right.
So let me add even, you see, unforgiveness is sin as any other sin. Because it is only sin that will impede your blessings from God. Why am I saying it's sin? It is disobedient to the commandment of God. That says that forgive others their debts. So if you refuse to forgive the debt of others, you are going against, or you are going contrary against the word of God that entreats you to forgive others. Now, when you do that, when we do that and put it that way, we give the enemy a strong stronghold in our lives that will actually prevent the hand of God. God said, my hands are not short to deliver you. But because of your sins, what will prevent the blessings of God from coming? It is only sin. And sin of disobedience, or some people say sin of omission and sin of commission, they all play a role. Because if you can't forgive, the Bible at the same time says, feed your enemies. It said, feed your enemies. So if the person is you consider the person who has offended you as your enemy, and you cannot, you know, you keep on keeping records. That means you keep records of what he has done. You are rather, you know, siphoning your blessings from God. Amen.
So, can I ask something? You know, sometimes also, God is so merciful. You know, he will still give, we are still alive just because of the mercy of God. And sometimes you can pray and he still answers you due to the mercy of God. But when we say about blessing, you know, blessings of God is not only like money or something like we teach, we were taught the other Wednesday, it's about your health.
Yeah.
It's about your children.
Right.
It's about, you know, everything around you is a blessing. Even your happiness. If you don't forgive somebody, you are not happy. Inward, you are not happy. Even your health, it says scientifically also, it affects your health. You can develop pressure ulcer in your stomach because of unforgiveness. Because it eats into your health. You can have high blood pressure.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it affects you personally, because even your facial expression, yes, you know, it takes a lot for you to frown your face. It takes a lot of blood constriction for you to frown your face than for you to laugh. So even physically, it affects you. Health-wise, it affects you. But you can still pray, God, do this, and God give it to you. But what about the other, the general blessings of God will be affected? So maybe sometimes you say, you know what, I pray and God answers me, so I'm fine with God. No, there are still some areas in you that are still affected.
Let me read something from Proverbs chapter 4, 28-29. He said, do not testify against your neighbor without cause, or use your lips to deceive. Do not say, I will do to him as he has done to me. Pay back. Like I think last week, Pastor Ward mentioned pay back. People want to pay back in their own coin. I will pay you back in their own coin. And you see, this is the Bible. Do not pay back. You see, it means forgive. Yes, forgive. He said, I will pay that man back or for what he did. How many times don't we say that? This man did this to me, this woman did this to me, and that I will. You see, when you do that, you are taking the things from the hands of God. You are behaving like you are God, because God said, vengeance is mine. Why are you taking vengeance? And when you take it, like we said, your prosperity will be hampered. I'm not talking about what you call blessing coming, but prosperity, total prosperity will be hampered. Certain things that you are, so let us sit down and examine ourselves when we know that we are not flowing with one another. Let's make amendments, because we want, as children of God, we want the Spirit of God to be mighty in our midst. We are not talking about individual, but we are talking about corporate flow of the Spirit of God. Because if two people in this ministry are at loggerheads, they don't want to talk to each other. No, this person, my spirit doesn't agree with him. So how can the Spirit of God flow when we meet together as a co? The man of God, Papa, will be preaching very strong messages, you know, that the Spirit of God must flow. But because of the contention between members, it cannot flow.
And you ask, we got.
I just want to add that when you don't forgive each other, it brings about the spirit of frustration. Because when I sit with you and I have something against you, I have ruined my whole entire day. Mm-hmm. I'm immediately frustrated. Just your presence. So even when I leave that gathering, my whole day is ruined. I have already allowed you to control my day, because I see you and I'm frustrated. Somebody talked to me and I'm not even telling them how my day is going anymore. I'm telling them that, you would never believe what happened. I seen that person that I don't like. Oh God, please, why is this happening to me? You understand what I'm saying? I have just allowed the spirit of frustration to take over everything. And it's not right at all.
Amen. Now the question we wanted to pose, that was not the area we're going today. Mm-hmm. Please make it a verse now, because we need to go to the main area.
Yeah, you have a point. We are no longer who we used to be. Do we move to a position where we hold grudges to lead to unforgiveness?
So,
like in the church, how do we come to a situation where we hold grudges to lead to a situation of forgiveness or unforgiveness?
We are all children of
God. What brings you about? How do you feel somebody is? When you feel offense in your heart, when you think that somebody has done something against you that is not supposed to be, when you expect that somebody does not maybe pay you back or reward you adequately for what they have done for that person, when you feel that somebody is belittling you, bringing you down. There are so many reasons why people hold offense against somebody. So even though we are children of God, we are humans. You have to understand that humans have emotions. And when these emotions are triggered by someone's action, advertently or inadvertently, sometimes you might even get offended and the other person does not even know that what he or she said or did offended you. Because you don't come out to tell that person, hey, look, what you did to me or what you said, I felt bad. But you hold it. You might see that person and smile, fake smile. But in your heart, you know that there's something in there that that person might not even know.
Yeah, but it would seem to me, though, because the way I feel, things are not about me. It's not about me. So if you do something to me today, tomorrow I will think about that, because I'm thinking about things to do.
Well, brother, that is
going to a situation where you are holding, because you step on my shoes, because you don't mind me with my wife, something is wrong.
Well,
should be a time when we know it's not about us.
What if you're describing is an ideal situation? We need to come down to the level of being human. Because believe me, one thing I always want us to do when we get together like this is let's not look at ideal situation. Let's not look at the spiritual situation. Let's look at ourselves. Look, everybody here, every person here, has at one point or the other held offense against somebody. Every person here, including me, including you, everybody, at one point or the other, you have failed to forgive somebody for some time. So let's get to that level of who we are. Not the, because sometimes when we talk in a crowd like this, we talk ideal situation. What the spiritual thing is supposed to be. No. What, who we are. Have you ever in your life had to face against somebody? Have you ever gotten to a point where you refuse to forgive, at least for a point? Have you got to that level? If there's anybody that never got to that level, raise your hand. No, let's be real. Because when we come together, let's be real and talk about our life.
Yeah.
Not spiritual, let's not be too spiritual. Let's not be too good or too ideal. Let's get to the practical us, who we are.
I agree with you. But you see, everybody must grow. When we grow, we are growing in the Lord. There are certain things at a certain point, it doesn't bother you anymore. Because you are letting the spirit man take over the flesh. Because when the flesh is still there, that is why when somebody does something, you see, from time to time, the flesh will show up.
Okay.
But when you are growing, you can immediately identify this. No, this is not of God. Let me.
What we are looking at now is how to grow.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we are here.
That is it.
Yeah, that process of growth.
Mm-hmm.
Is why we are discussing
that, right?
Yeah.
So that we'll be able to get to that point where a brother sins against you.
Mm-hmm.
And let me add before my sister comes, I want us to also get to this point of understanding. It is easier to help me to forgive if you can come to me to ask for forgiveness.
Mm-hmm.
Now sometimes you might not be willing to do that because of pride, but how do we go beyond pride and still forgive that person? Because believe me, if I know I offend you and I come to you and ask for forgiveness, it's very easy. Unless something else is wrong with you,
mm-hmm.
it's easy to forgive.
Mm-hmm.
But if I don't have to wait for you to come, how do I get to that point that I don't have to wait for you, whether you acknowledge that you offended me or not,
mm-hmm.
how do I get to that point where I will, on my own, because of the Spirit of God in me, forgive you wholeheartedly? Because sometimes we think about forgiveness as if we do forgive, but we don't forgive. I might say, oh, I've forgiven you, but you know you are not.
You keep where you are.
When you see that person,
keeping the record of what the person has done. And that is one of the things that is hampering our growth in the Lord. Not keeping record of what the person has done. And how do we come to that point? Pastor Elizabeth said something. She said, unforgiveness is not affecting that person. It is you. When you begin to view it from that perspective, hey, if I don't forgive this person,
It is affecting me rather. Sometimes, like Pastor said, the person doesn't know that he has offended you. And you keep that thing inside of you. It is, you know, Pat said, you see, when you get angry at to a certain point because somebody has offended you, your body begins to emit dangerous chemicals in your body, which can affect your pressure, which can even cause diabetes and everything in your body. So please, when the Bible talks about forgiveness, God knows the consequences of unforgiveness and holding, you know, somebody inside of you. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
No, let's wrap that up there. There was the reason why we had to bring this up again today. Because we're going to be pushed around in a circle. How do you forgive an unbeliever? How do you forgive an unbeliever? A person that's not a child of God. Now, what we're talking basically is within the context of children of God.
Yeah.
Among ourselves, we that know Jesus, we that are the followers of Jesus Christ. The question then becomes, because like I said before, it shouldn't be hard for us to forgive one another as children of God, no matter what that person did to you. If that person is a child of God, you're a child of God, you get the point. Of course, anger will come. Make no mistake about that. Anybody that says that you're not going to get angry, you're lying.
Yeah.
Because the first reaction that brings about forgiveness is anger. But the Bible says, anger is a natural emotional reaction when you feel that somebody hurts you. But don't allow it to lead to sin. It should not bring harden that of forgiveness in you. But how do we forgive somebody that's not in the same fold with us?
With the question, is there any different theory that regards an unbeliever and a believer? If you're someone that has that spirit of forgiveness, it should not even matter if the person is a Christian or a non-Christian.
Mm. Okay, let me rephrase the question. When you forgive a believer, a forgiveness of a believer is told, meaning you have to go back to the relationship the way it was when you started. For instance, I know you, you know me. We've been friends for a while before we met in the house of God. And we are now Christian together in the same house of God. You offend me, I will distance myself from you. Naturally, when somebody offends you and you don't forgive yet, the first thing you do is to distance yourself.
Yeah.
But when you forgive, that relationship should go back to where it was. I supposed to be as a child of God. Supposed to relate again together the way it's supposed to be. That is because you are a believer. I am a believer. Now the question becomes, if I forgive an unbeliever, how is that relationship supposed to be?
The Bible tells us that we should be wise as a serpent and gentle as a dove. Now, it's also, in my own understanding, it also means that if I'm to forgive that person, it doesn't mean that that mingling is going to be as to the level of, if it's going to put me in a situation where I am an unbeliever or going back to the things I shouldn't do, because the Bible also tells that evil communication corrupts good manners. If you forgive an unbeliever, it is something for you. But in terms of going back to relating that same, that is where you now become as wise as a serpent. You have to know that if that person is not willing to come into your faith and believe and change to be a believer, there should be a sort of distancing from that person.
Amen. Romans chapter 8, verse 12. Let's look at that quickly. Romans chapter 8, verse 12. There's something that I want us to draw from there. Or maybe 18. Let's look at verse 18. Romans 12,
18. It's in Romans 12, verse 18. It says, if it be possible, as much as lies in you, live peace all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourself, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Therefore, if your enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, you shall heap coals of fire on his head.
Okay. Now, where I'm going is, as much, what other version of the Bible do you have? Mr. Terry, do you have that in your
university
version?
Oh, okay.
Any other version of the Bible? Romans 12, verse 13.
What about my phone?
Romans
12, 18.
In Amplifier, he said, if possible, as far as it depends on you.
If possible, as far as it depends on you.
Live at peace with everyone.
Live at peace with everyone. Let's stop there. Now, this one is talking about everyone, not believers.
Yes.
The Bible says, if possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. And there's something that I wanted to draw out here. This one basically refers to unbelievers. Everyone that is not in the fold. Now, we have to get to that point because why I brought this up is something that came up last week when we were talking about this unforgiveness. The relationship you have with a believer should not be the same at the same level with the one you have with an unbeliever. When you forgive a believer, forgiveness should be complete and total. In other words, you should be able to go back to the way you start. Meaning, if I say I forgive you in this church, and I'm not able to relate with you the way I used to relate with you before, I am not forgiving you.
That's right.
I am not. Make no mistake about that. I want you to get that clear. If I used to relate with you friendly, we eat together as believers. Something happened, of course, things will happen. We get distracted by the enemy. But I say in my heart, I have forgiven you. Yet, we don't relate the way we used to. Forgiveness has not taken place. We're just pretending. But as a believer, you cannot translate that to an unbeliever. When you forgive an unbeliever, it might be wise to distance yourself. Because I always say this in this church. If I forgive you, how am I sure you are forgiving me? Because forgiveness is a two-way street. If I forgive Pastor Daniel, I'm not in his heart. I can't tell that he has forgiven me. The only reason I will believe he has forgiven me because he's a child of God. But if he's not a child of God in the same fold, and I forgive him, I cannot get myself to the level we were before. Because he might not have forgiven me.
That's right.
He might be through getting by because I'm a child of God. Like my sister said, we should be wise. He might be through getting by that he will have me.
Yeah, to pay it back.
That person will have me. So, we have to get to that point of be very careful. He said, as much as it depends on you, if it's possible, when we read the word of God, I wanted to read with understanding. Because we can generalize everything.
Yes.
Is that statement is key in forgiving an unbeliever. You see, if it is possible, as much as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. So we need to be very wise. I share a story of my cousin. Both of them were my cousins, the older cousin and the junior cousin. The older cousin was very, very influential. The junior cousin, the senior cousin felt he had that his junior cousin had offended him. So for a year, they did not talk. So people got in, intervened, and said, okay, they need to get back together. So the junior cousin went to the senior one, asked for forgiveness, everything felt right. The senior cousin organized annual Thanksgiving, invited the junior one to come. He went because he felt everything was okay. Ed died that night. The senior cousin poisoned him. He went back home and died the next day. Why? because the junior cousin who was a child of God felt that everything was okay. But that was how he met his death, because of forgiveness. So that's why we need to be wise as a servant when you are dealing with unbelievers. But when you are dealing with your fellow believer, we have to get to a point that you go back and believe God that this person is a believer. Mm-hmm. And we go from there. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Okay. I want to verify, as we are talking about this, if you forgive your fellow Christian and maybe something happened and everything is sorted out, to understand the whole thing is you can see there is no unforgiveness and men of God come inside, sort it out, and it's still like that. I think as a Christian, you know that you have forgiven. The other counterpart is not giving. You should ignore her. That's my national anthem I use. I will ignore you. Because in my heart, I know I've forgiven you. I just don't want to even look at what is happening to hurt myself. Is it wrong to do that way? Because in my heart, that's what I feel. I'm all right. I know my heart, I've forgiven. The person, the counterpart is not incorporating. I just leave her and behave like I just know her.
Okay.
I'm not going to interact with her as I used to be because she's not giving me the chance to be, relate to her as I'm supposed to be. I'll just ignore her for me not to sin against the law. Yeah. Is there wrong with that for being ignoring her?
My question is similar. My question is, can forgiveness and unforgiveness be a one-way or one-sided? It goes to the same thing.
Okay. It's the same thing. Yes, it is possible that you forgive a brother, you forgive a sister in the church. I'm talking about church now. It doesn't have to be this church. I'm talking about Christian generally. It's possible that you forgive somebody who is a fellow believer, but that person does not want to relate with you. It is possible. You can't form relationship. And that's because we are still at various levels of relationship with God, even though we're all born again. There are people that are just starting out. They are yet to understand what we're talking about here. There are people that are at advanced level. That is why the Bible says there are people that are drinking milk and others that are breaking bones. Mm-hmm. So you know that if I offend you or you offend me and we feel that we have met up, everything is okay, we should be able to go back to the way we started because of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. But if I try to, come across to you and you are not letting me, I can't force you. All I want to make sure is that my heart is right with man and God. Okay. Move on. But that doesn't mean that you should. Every once in a while, make a move. Approach the sister. Talk to the sister. That is a clear sign that your heart is clear with that sister or with that brother. Whether that person wants to respond or not, it doesn't matter. You are stand with God, is sure. But then because that person doesn't want to give it, once in a while make it know, that is a sign of forgiveness. Yes, like Brother Tony said, forgiveness is possible for forgiveness to be one way. Because if I forgive you and you refuse to forgive me, God knows that I have forgiven you. So I don't expect, I expect that you should forgive me too. But if I forgive you and you refuse, there's nothing I can do about that. I can't force you to forgive me. But all I want to make sure is that my heart is right with God.
Amen. Let me ask Pastor, you see, forgiveness is a sacrifice. Something that you cannot let go, but you let go, is a sacrifice. So, let's try as much as we can to sacrifice that part that doesn't want to go and let go for our own sake. For my sake, I will forgive you. Even if you don't want to accept it, I'll forgive you. And I'll try as many times as I can, like Pastor is saying, to bring my hand. If you don't give me a handshake, it is up to you. God will answer my prayers because he knows that I have taking the responsibility to let go of whatever happened between us.
Sister Janet, it happened to her to know was walking at the back. He was older than me. The other people think he was slow. To the old man, they don't give him a job they don't like. So I was the one who saved him. So when I went on vacation, I told him I'm afraid I may not come to see. So I left. Before I come out the fire, then about a few months later, we had to buy a Volkswagen for our engineer. So we went to Volkswagen place. You know, in Nigeria, I buy people to buy vehicles. You can beg them to come and get it, then you're running away. Guess what we saw in that department? It was entirely vehicle. We was that guy. So I went straight to him. I told him, I said, no, no problem. I can make what you help me. You told me was true. You sold out the bay without a bribe. You will never know who God is going to use to bless you. So the beginning of God has things for everybody. So when you ignore them, you're telling God I don't want this. Or you don't know. The fact can also tell you, she had a problem here with a woman at Presbyterian. They were not going to write about him, what I'm about him in a lawsuit. So when Pilate pressed me, he went to Caramon Hill. That very woman came to look for what Caramon Hill Pam was, and the person who was interviewing her. When she walked into that room, asked back, she was more like she would not cave into the ground. Even though they gave her that job, she couldn't take it. Make peace with all people, you know, be social.
Amen.
Life is about being social.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Don't tell me. The time is up. Next week or some other time. Minister, God bless you. Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
As we wrap this up, don't forget there's a verse in the Bible. When the word of God says something, what does he say? He said, if a brother offends you and he comes to ask for forgiveness, underline the word, come to ask. What do I say? Underline that word or that sentence, come to ask. Why do I put that? Let's always be quick to ask for forgiveness. Because we talk about the spirit of pride in this church. What will make you not to ask for forgiveness? The spirit of pride. Even between husband and wife, you see that a lot. In the church of God, you see that a lot. You know that somebody has something against you. Whether you are wrong or right, it doesn't matter. It is important that you develop that habit of quickly asking for forgiveness. It makes forgiveness to be easy. Amen.
Amen.
Shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The Lord will help us.
Holy.
Say the Lord will help me.
The Lord will help me.
When we talk like this, let's not talk as if we are talking to others. Because we have these children of God, we are so religious. When we are talking, we are like, I'm talking to them, not me. When we talk, let's try to talk to ourselves. Amen.
Amen. That's